الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا قيما لينذر بأسا شديدا من لدنه ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا حسنا ماكثين فيه أبدا وينذر الذين قالوا اتخذ الله ولدا ما لهم به من علم ولا لآبائهم كبرت كلمة تخرج من أفواههم إن يقولون إلا كذبا فلعلك باخع نفسك على آثارهم إن لم يؤمنوا بهذا الحديث أسفا إنا جعلنا ما على الأرض زينة لها لنبلوهم أيهم أحسن عملا وإنا لجاعلون ما عليها صعيدا جرزا أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أي الحزبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا ربنا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها لقد قلنا إذا شططا هؤلاء قومنا اتخذوا من دونه آلهة لولا يأتون عليهم بسلطان بين فمن أظلم ممن افترى على الله كذبا وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم وإذ اعتزلتموهم وما يعبدون إلا الله فأووا إلى الكهف ينشر لكم ربكم من رحمته ويهيئ لكم من أمركم مرفقا وترى الشمس إذا طلعت تزاور عن كهفهم ذات اليمين وإذا غربت تقرضهم ذات الشمال وهم في فجوة منه ذلك من آيات الله من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وتحسبهم أيقاظا وهم رقود ونقلبهم ذات اليمين وذات الشمال وكلبهم باسط ذراعيه بالوصيد لو اطلعت عليهم لوليت منهم فرارا ولملئت منهم رعبا وكذلك بعثناهم ليتساءلوا بينهم قال قائل منهم كم لبثتم قالوا لبثنا يوما أو بعض يوم قالوا ربكم أعلم بما لبثتم فابعثوا أحدكم بورقكم هذه إلى المدينة فلينظر أيها أزكى طعاما فليأتكم برزق منه وليتلطف ولا يشعرن بكم أحدا إنهم إن يظهروا عليكم يرجموكم أو يعيدوكم في ملتهم ولن تفلحوا إذا أبدا وكذلك أعثرنا عليهم ليعلموا أن وعد الله حق
Begin, inshallah, with remembering Palestine. And the video that was just playing is actually a very dear close friend of mine, Dr. Adam Fahis, who was in Gaza. And he went, and I remember seeing him the night before he went there, and as he talks about before, but he had basically kind of submitted his affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and said that basically, you know, this is a duty upon us to go. And whatever happens, happens. And he prepared to leave this world. And I think one of the most important messages he mentioned also really resonates with me, just to really quickly. So as a young child, I had leukemia. And when I grew up, there's a long backstory, inshallah, for another time. But basically, that remembrance of death will basically put you, inshallah, on a trajectory where, God willing, Allah becomes the center of your universe, the center of your attention, and will become the driving force in everything that you do. So I'm just going to begin, inshallah, with a poem that should, as a reminder to myself first and foremost, but snap us out of this mentality, this materialistic, commercialistic, capitalistic system that we live in, and keep in mind our greater duties, like our dear brother Adam, sallallahu alaihi Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Hussein, can you cut the music? Can you turn it off? Yeah, better. Sure. Politics. No, they're not for me. Why waste my time thinking about something that I can't change? Especially when speaking up may affect my job, and to live, I have to get paid. I feel bad about everything that is happening and all. But I can't put my career or degree on the line if I get involved. And why would I? When anyways, this world's problems will never be solved. Sound familiar? It seems that some people's eyes work, but it's just that they see in reverse. Where they look at the entire world but can only see their self-worth. But if they would only close their eyes and see with their heart's empathy, to feel what it's like to live under military occupation and misery, daily living on the barrel's end of merciless Israeli infantry, every day in your face, guns being drawn, where it wasn't your choice to be strong, but it was necessary for your survival. Now imagine someone from Palestine, looking in your eyes, could you look away? Could you simply say that politics are not necessary? This is not a genre in a board game. This is not Jeopardy. While you sit on the couch of first world safety, having the luxury to look away and plug back into the matrix. But unplug and take a look around. You may not be able to change this world overnight, but you do matter. Your voice can change. Even if when you utter enough is enough, only your room shakes, for underneath it is the earth in which reverberates through one human family like the lining of vertebrae. And when one part of the body is harmed, the rest of it must rush to its aid, for there will come a day when it is you and your family between the crosshairs. And don't you dare say that it's not fair, that no one cares, for when you were in a state of ease, you left your brothers and sisters to fall as casualties. You let them die with their necks crushed by knees to appease, out of fear from the police, your employer, your government. But is life even worth living if it is not lived with righteousness? You must speak, stand up, write letters, make videos, use your talent. I know you have it inside of you. Can you hear the whisper of the child raising their hands to the sky, wondering when divine help will intercede between their screams and cries, with dirt and sand covering their clothes, all that's left from their demolished home that Israel bulldozed? Made possible through U.S. taxpayer money, weapons, and drones. Yes, the U.S. is our home. But the housekeeper is a serial killer. And the only sin you could commit as a citizen is not screaming to the world and sounding the alarms, for it is an accessory to murder to not try and stop the killers in charge. No one is saying to take up arms, but to at least lift up tongues, screaming in to the light of the sun what is being done. And as it rotates around the earth, the light of truth will be shown to everyone. A dark world where killing, oppression, and massacres could happen in the cover of closed doors has begun to fade. And the oppressors know their oppression has taken the brightness of center stage. The question is, will the audience have something to say? Or will they sit quietly, watching it all like a play? The answer to that, I'll leave for you to say.
Salawat. Ahsant. Ahsant. Bismillah. Bismillah. All praise be to Allah, the Lord of the worlds. May His peace and blessings be on our beloved Prophet and His Immaculate Ahlul Bayt. Salawat. Thank you. It's still hard every day to find joy when we know. Is there an echo? Okay. Everybody, don't move. Just kill that. Bismillah. Still an echo? Yes. Okay. Still hard to be sad. I mean, still hard to be happy moments. You find moments of joy, but it's still unfortunate, and it's getting worse. And they're even more bold with their claims, saying, and even people are saying, the same way the Nazis treated the Jews before the war is the same way the Jews are now treating the Palestinians. And who is saying this? The Israelis. Their board, their generals. They're saying it's the same exact thing. So we have, this is a huge wake-up call. So the question is, what do we do about it? And that's what these classes are about. How do we purify ourselves for chance that you can help the people who can't help themselves? be it in Palestine, in Yemen, or anything. That way, when you're ready to leave this world, you're leaving pleased because you're of service of others. But the only way to become service of others is you first have to be of service to yourself to get closer to Allah. Right now is a billion-dollar industry for you to be of service to yourself to get closer to yourself in order to manifest things. That's a form of shirk. So that's why there's coaches, life coaches, gurus, they're all telling you focus on the self. Stay in the present moment. To do what? To create things from the field of possibility. And we know you can do that. That's quantum physics. But if it does, if the picture leaves out Allah, then what's the point? Because what if those things that you create from the field take you away from Allah? How do you know? That's why the prayer that you always make, Allah, only bring it to me if it brings me closer to you. And Allah, take it away from me if it takes it away from you. I did that prayer in 2007 with my friends. I said, Allah, take everything away from me. And it was a prayer from the heart. And Allah removed all my friends. I said, wow, and I became very depressed. Now, does that mean you should call your friend and say, hey, we can't be friends anymore? No. It's Allah who does that for you in the most mysterious of ways. Then I asked Allah, I'm depressed. Bring me new friends that bring me closer to you. And the first friend he brought me was Haj Hassanin. And then from there, you know, we created many programs and projects, and we're still doing it. You know, the same way we're doing it in 2007 is the same way we're doing it today. And it's Haj Hassanin's energy that keeps driving, keeps pushing. And he's got an energy unlike anything else. He's a lion. And when it comes to principles, he protects this institution because he knows it's not his, it's Allah's. Without him, this would be impossible. So then the reason why now I started speaking is to say, okay, now we need a community full of people to do that. So that's what this discussion is about. How do we go from one group to another where you start a potential of a change of a movement? So when you're ready to leave this world, you leave pleased. So what's the journey of the soul? Oh, shaitan's working today. In the journey of the soul, the first step is to break all affinities and rely upon Allah alone, so no cause save him is independent. Meaning, anything that you have, your glasses, your hijab, your glasses, your sweater, your shoes, the chair you're sitting on, the water that's in that bottle, your coffee, that phone, it's all Allah's. Everything. And the reason why you have it is from Allah, not from you. You're nothing. If you put anything outside of whatever you have is not from Allah, you are nothing. How dare you even think that? And that's where the ego comes to play. So how do you break that affinity? And we have the only religion to break that affinity. So the question, next question, the philosophy of the blank, salam, is to break one free from all causes and obey Allah alone and see everything dependent upon him. You take care of your kids because of Allah, not because of you. Your boss doesn't pay you, it's Allah. When you get sick, it's Allah that heals you. When you have a cut, you don't have to think about it, it does it for you. So what is the blank? Talk to the person next to you and try to fill in the blank. Go. 20 bucks, whoever gets it. And wise students, because I gave them this question, they're not allowed to answer. All right, who would like to guess? Prayer. Okay, this is the umbrella. Prayer is under that. Who else would like to guess? Dunya. Well, dunya is under this. How you participate in dunya. Religion is within this, yes. Religion is very close. Mind, no. Enlightenment, no. You have to get true enlightenment, you have to do this. Dua, you have to do this. Your soul, no. To purify your soul, you have to do this. No. Huh? Read Quran is under this. Submissive is under this. It's the first step in Islam, and you think it's the last step because of what you've been preached. And the reason why you do it is because somebody's told you, if you don't do these things, you will end up in hell. Or you could end up in a heaven. It's a business relationship. What are these things? Sharia. How'd you, did one of the wise students tell you? It is Sharia. Sharia is, what's Sharia? The rules. Rules from who? God. Why are you looking for your own rules, or your friend's rules, or your boss's rules? Are rules meant to be broken? Yes. Only if they what? Allah says. They disobey who? God. No. Even in the Quran it says, disobey your parents if they disobey who? God. That, but how do you do that? You have to break affinity to this world. So how do we do that? That's what we're going to discuss today. So, eyes closed. Okay, I want you to look at everything in this room that's brown. Everybody look around, look for brown, quickly. Look for all the brown things that you see. All right, let's everybody do this exercise. It takes 5 seconds. Okay, everybody found it? All right, close your eyes, everybody. Close your eyes. Now, tell yourself, what did you see that was pink? Okay, open your eyes. How many pink things did you see when you were looking for brown? One, maybe, right? But if I told you to look for red things or pink things or brown things, you would be able to tell me. Why? Because that's what you were given attention to. So whatever you give attention to is your belief. So belief is a thought that you have over and over. That's what you will see. So how many of you wake up and only give attention to negative things versus positive things? And if you only pay attention to the negative, when somebody tells you there's something positive in your life, you will fight against them saying, nothing is positive, I don't see it. That's when I do counseling. When I talk to people, it's too expensive, it's too hard, nothing's working out, everything's conspiring. What do? I say, okay, where'd you get that bad, that's really bad programming, where'd you get it from? Your mom, your dad? Because I always ask them, how's your childhood? They say, oh, it was okay. And then you dig in, you say, yeah, my father was a creep, right? Because if they're broke, they have bad relationships, they've been divorced, their kids are astray, something's bad, that's because they were given a program where they were told, just look at the bad things in life, and you're the reason why everything is bad. There's one lady who had cancer, and they figured out, because they couldn't figure out, because most, if you go to a regular doctor, most of these diseases, they don't know where it starts from. They'll treat the symptoms, but not the cause. What was the cause in this case? It was from childhood, when she brought in broccoli to share with the kids, and all the kids made fun of her. It killed her self-esteem to the point where she never shared with anybody. And 30 years of giving that attention every day, your body's going to make you sick. And where did it come from when a hypnotherapist worked with her? From that. And then all she had to do to release the cancer was forgive her students that hurt her 20 years ago. Why? Because every day she was waking up to that reality. And your mind and your body don't know the difference, does not know the difference between that reality that happened 20 years ago and it happening right now. It's wherever you place your attention. Apply that lesson to the person next to you and say, what do you give attention to every day? Go. Are they more positive or negative?
Hush, thank you, that was beautiful. You don't like the music? Do we have to work one day? Find the right one.
We'll do it one day. It was beautiful. Okay. So you have 70,000 thoughts a day. This country has a pandemic with diseases, cancer, mental health, incarceration, all because of our thoughts. No other country has the problems that we have. And what's the proof? Is no other country has more people in prison than we do. No other country has more health issues than we do. And that's fact.
So question is, why? It's because what people are giving attention to every day. And it's programmed into you to say, okay, this is the way things should be. And when you live in a state of fear every day where you watch the news and you get programmed, it's going to have an impact on you. So that's one of the things we're going to try to end the program is, how do we reprogram that? How do we change that? So I need your best. I want to try to end right at 9, but there's a lot of information I'm about to throw at you. Can you give me your best? I don't want to fight for your attention, so leave your phone. Just give me the next 40 minutes. Just give me your best. I'm going to fly through this, but then hopefully it'll all come together at the end. Okay. Start with why, chapter 7, tipping points. So there's the innovators. The innovators are the ones who first bought the iPhone. They are first willing to buy the $1,000 or the $40,000 flat screen. When flat screens first came out, $40,000. If they would have just waited 1 or 2 years, they're the ones that don't wait. Then there's the early adapters who follow the innovators. So that's 13.5%, 2.5%. Then there's the early majority. They're going to go with them. But if a business doesn't get these two, then you're never going to get here. You can manipulate this group. What's this group? I'll buy a pair of jeans if I feel it's worth it. I'll buy a pair of shoes. This group, like the laggers, they'll be the last ones to buy a fancy car or a cell phone to go from a flip phone. It's very hard to convince them. What most businesses do is they'll manipulate, say, buy one, get one free. Try for 30 days. They'll manipulate you to try. But if you're not sold on it, eventually it will fall apart. So then the question is, how do we apply this to religion? Because this is the biggest problem of religion. Islam came, the prophet. Who were the innovators that the prophet came with? Which one was the first? Imam Ali. How long did the prophet it take for him to get this group going? 13 years. Then he went to Medina the last 10 years. Eventually, he got all of them. But it took him the first 53 years of his life to get this group. It was work. But when it did, then there was a wave that came. That's how business, that's how Apple works, that's how everything works. And most businesses fail when they only focus on this. They manipulate. So we're going to talk about that. So what do I do? I need to figure out, when I'm counseling, who am I dealing with? If I'm dealing with a lagger that mom forced them to come see me, or a husband who's forced by his wife to come see me, the possibility of me trying to change this person is very low. Somebody that I only speak about 10 minutes for, right? Because he was manipulated to come. It's like, you ever try to take a person who doesn't really want to go to the mosque and you try to force him through manipulation? Well, guess what? Is that going to work? No. Short term, but not long term. Eventually, you'll lose them. So how do we overcome? So I was going to talk the business aspect, but I'm going to skip and we're going to go right to the religion aspect. Innovators in religion, a small group within religion communities who inspire others to see their faith and spirituality different. That's an innovator. Who are the innovators in our community? Who are the 2.5%? Who should be the innovators? Our scholars, right? The Sayyids. We have Sayyid Kazwini. We have Sheikh Ilahi. We have the other scholars. If they are not the innovators, right, then what will happen to the other groups? No, it won't work. We agree? Okay. Then there's the early adopters, similar to religious innovators. These individuals are quick to embrace new theological ideas and spiritual practices, accepting imperfections, and see potential growth. They're willing to give it a try. Okay? Those who adopt new forms of worship, spiritual practices, they're willing to try new things. Their early majority, that's the 34%, more practical minds, somewhat open to new religious ideas and practices. When will they come? Is when the early adapters start. They see them, they're motivated by them, so okay, I'm going to try that because you tried that. Right? Think about the things that you buy. Why do they pay LeBron James to sell car insurance? Does he know anything about car insurance? No, but you're manipulated to think, well, if he did it and he's innovative, then I'm going to follow that. That's why they pay them millions of dollars. Late majority, practical but less open to new religious concepts compared to early majority. And then highly resistant to change in faith. These are the last ones. You want me to go to Hajj? You want me to pray? You want me to wear hijab? I'm fine. Why would I ever change? God hasn't hit me in a lightning bolt. I'm happy. Why? And religion, to me, is just a business. Why would I ever change? And those are the hardest to change. So now when you're trying to come and you're trying to change a family member and he's a lagger and you're trying to do it with somebody who's like an innovator or early adapter and you treated him like that, what's going to happen? It's not going to work. So the question is, how do you fix that? Because if you want to make a change, where does the change have to start? With you. So which one are you when it comes to religion? See, okay, first start. Which one are you when it comes to, like, for instance, my wife is a power lifter, Olympic lifter, sorry. Get yelled at. She'll lift more weight than any guy in this room, right? She's very strong. So I don't, my son is like, I want to be strong like my mom, unfortunately. So she's definitely the strongest person in this room, okay? And I asked her, so for her, it's weightlifting shoes. She'll buy the newest ones and pay triple the price and wait in line for an hour to get them, where she could have just waited a week to get it. Think about some of you when it comes to the phone. Right when the iPhone comes out, people will wait an hour. They're willing, who are the innovators? Who are the early adapters? They're willing to struggle. So people are willing to wait in front of Apple to buy an iPhone, an hour. Even though they could wait a week later, they won't. Or they could wait even longer for cheaper. That's who they are. So the question is, when it comes to the iPhone, which one are you? Have a quick discussion with the person, with the next new phone. Go. Which one are you? Okay, do we have any laggards? Anybody a laggard when it comes to their phone? Sam? So you're a laggard. So you'll be the last one. Which iPhone? The laggard is the one that's still probably holding on to the iPhone 11 with the button, right? My mother-in-law is a laggard. I tried to get her a new phone. She says, no, I like my button. Right? They're the last people to change. And if you try to force it on them, what do they say? No. But eventually, over time, they will change. How? Because they got inspired by the innovators, the adapters, the majority, the late. Then they see that everybody, they're like, okay, now I'm convinced. Because there's been enough people to tell me it's okay to change, it's safe. So, importance of identifying faith groups. Crucial for religious leaders to recognize and focus on engaging which group that are more open to new ideas and spiritual growth. When it comes to religion, which one are you? Go. You need to know. If somebody came with a new concept, would you question it? A new prayer? Would you be analytical about it? Will you just submit? Somebody told you we have a free trip to Hajj. Would you go right away? Okay, who, any laggards in religion? You don't have to answer a question. Well, actually, yeah, if you're gonna raise your hand, I'm gonna ask you a question. Anybody brave enough to raise their hand if they're a laggard? Laggard is the last one to change. Last one to accept, surrender, and believe in anything anybody says when it comes to religion. So you could be, you are? A laggard, a good point. Why would a laggard be here? That's smart. Wow, very smart. Straight A student? That was a very observant, that was very, very good. So when would a laggard, And usually any laggard that's here is like almost an energy vampire. They just suck the energy out of the room. Why? Because they were forced to come here. By who? My parents. So the parents didn't identify them as a laggard, saying, this isn't how you do it. This isn't how you change people. The Prophet would tell people, you're the reason why you brought this person to Islam, but you're also the same reason why he left Islam. You did too much too soon. And what happens is when parents especially do this with their kids, because that pain of seeing them get away from Allah, they're willing to try anything and everything. And I will get a phone call at, or text at 2 o'clock in the morning. And my wife now is the one telling me, stop. You're not going to save somebody at 2 o'clock in the morning. They're just desperate. They're going to have to go through it. They're not ready. So, definition of spiritual loyalty. Faithful individuals willing to endure challenges or go against mainstream for their beliefs. Meaning, is Islam for sale? If somebody gave you $1 million to take off your hijab, would you do it? If you would, then you're not the first two. If somebody told you stop praying for $1 billion, would you do it, right? If, here's how you really know, and this is the question that I want you to talk to the person next to you. If heaven was promised, no matter what you did, would you still pray? Have that conversation with the person next to you. You're still going to the highest of heavens. Would you still pray or wear hijab or follow? Would you? Okay. And that, and I still know for sure, my biggest fear is that there's something that entices me in this world that I don't die a Muslim because of some external thing that I get manipulated and tricked by. And that's my biggest fear. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam says, just want to die a Muslim. He was a prophet of God. If that's a prophet saying, then who are we? That's why we always have to be on guard. It's our ego thinking, okay, we're good enough. We don't have to worry. Leave the Sharia alone. I'm a good person. No, you always have to be on guard. How would you know you're on guard? Is irregardless of a reward, you're going to worship God because you love him. Imagine going to your dad and say, Dad, the only reason I love you is because you pay for my car bill. What would your dad say? You get a slap, right, or something. Hopefully not. Why slap? Jeez. We got to talk. But drama. So, but we do that with God. God, I'm doing this because I don't want to get hurt by you. I don't want to get in hell. That's unfortunately the relationship of God. It's not too much of a love relationship, so how do we get there? We're going to talk about that. Salam. Focusing on early adapters in faith eventually attract majority, emphasizing the importance of understanding the why behind new spiritual practices. If you are a late, laggard, early, you want to focus on the two. You need to be a friend of them because they're the ones that have applied Islam. Something has happened in their life. They had an experience. That's why the Prophet would just look at people, touch them, they would heal. Blind people, they'd be able to see. People with broken arms, he would fix them. People would witness that and said, oh my God, look what Islam could do for you. And people would be so motivated to change. So then how do you change people? You don't, but you change yourself. They get so motivated because they're so excited to be like you because you're the role model. That's how you start something mainstream. Unfortunately, that's something we're lacking. Do you agree? Yes. What's the data? Because those three groups are not mainstream. They're not praying. They're not following the Sharia. Majority. You agree? But who's the fault? It's not them. It's these two groups. Why is there poor people in the world? Is it because they're stupid? Is it because they're in lack? Or is it because the rich don't know how to present it to the poor? Which one? It's the rich. They don't give. Same with Islam. You're born Muslim. You are the richest individual on earth. You're born with the truth. Why is majority of the world non-Muslim? It's not because of them. It's because of who? Me. That's it. And as soon as the Imam returns, he's going to create an innovation to the early adapters. It's going to start a wave instantly. The key is for you to do that within your own soul and your own circle. That's what your life is for. That's your purpose. Make sense? Did I lose you guys, or did that make sense? Okay. So look out. You guys know what TiVo was? They were one of the first companies to market recording. You could leave and record TV. This is how they marketed it. We've got a new product. It pauses live TV, skips commercials, rewinds live TV, memorizes your viewing habits, and records shows on your behalf. They went bankrupt. They had to sell their company. They still exist in a small form, but other companies took them over that weren't as good as them. Why? Why would this fail? Because this is how we preach Islam. Where did this focus on? Between the why, the how, and the what. What did it focus on? What and how. Does it focus on the why? In Islam, do we focus on the why, how, or what? Not the why. How to pray. What to do, how to do it, but not the why. Right? That's the reason why it doesn't become mainstream like it should. Because they're getting people to manipulate, saying, you better pray or else. But why? How is it going to impact me right now? Not a million years from now in Barzakh. Now. Why are you putting fear into me, saying if I don't do it, I'm going to be punished? What's wrong? Something's missing. It goes bankrupt in that person's soul, and they're not attracted to it. I don't want it. Even though it could be the best device, even though it's the best religion, because the why is weak, we fall apart. Does that make sense? Now look how another company, who became a billion-dollar company with not as good as device. If you're the kind of person who likes to have total control of every aspect of your life, we have the product for you. What does this focus on? The why. Why am I going to practice Islam? Why am I going to buy a recording device? Here's my why. And then it tells you what and how. They missed the why. So why did they fail? They had no idea how to market it. Same with us. We don't know how to market the deen. It's so easy to market because all you need is Allah. But we market it very poorly. Well, we've made Islam a business. It's a business card. And it's religious organizations, unfortunately, across the world, are more about organizations than the religion. What's the proof? Palestine. If it was truly about the religion, we wouldn't have these issues in Palestine. Okay. You guys know who this is? Dr. Shariati. So I have a friend, Mahmoud Abdul Rauf. He went to Hajj. He read this book. And he said, okay, my first Hajj didn't count. And then he went back to Hajj. This was during his MBA career. Dr. Shariati was a person under Shahid Mutahari. He had Eastern and Western education, where even his teacher, in Oxford, he was very smart, said, I don't follow religion, but if I did, I'd follow the religion of Shariati. He wrote books about Imam Hussein. He wrote a book called Fatima is Fatima. Fatima doesn't need Imam Ali for her to stand. She doesn't need the Prophet. She's enough alone. She wrote a book, Fatima is Fatima. He wrote a book on Hajj. Guess, on Hajj, when you hear mostly about Hajj, what do you hear about? Why, how, or what? How and what? Do you really focus on the why? No. What did he do? He revolutionized Hajj. He really got people to understand, why do we go? So look how he transformed. Ihram. What's ihram? The clothes. Why do you wear it? What's the spiritual meaning? I'm just going to give you a few. And my suggestion, everybody read this book. When I went to Umrah last, I read it twice on my way there to Saudi-occupied Arabia. All right. He said, the act of wearing ihram symbolizes the removal of certain negative human characteristics represented by various animals. So he says, you're going to take off the clothes, shed the clothes, and you're not allowed to look in the mirror because it's not about an outer dress, it's about a what? Inner. So then you have to say, what is the garb that you're wearing? And he gave a few examples. Because when the imam would come, I forget what number of the imam, Hassan, you could help me, but I think it was the fourth imam. He said, mashallah, look how many people are here. Look how many Muslims. And then he put his two fingers, he says, look here. And when the companion looked through the two fingers, all he saw was animals. So here, people are here not for the reasons of Allah. They're here for themselves. And think about it. Hajj has become a what? A vacation. So he brings the spirit back. So what does he say? He says, a wolf. Take off the skin of the clothes of a wolf. What is that? Represents aggressive, oppressive behavior. Wearing ihram signifies shedding the aggressive nature. Are we you aggressive? When somebody tells you the wrong thing or hits a nerve, do you right away say something? Do you right away respond? Can you remove that for Allah? That every time somebody triggers you, can you hold and be patient? The rat symbolized craftiness and causing trouble while appearing innocent. Do you manipulate situations? Do you become crafty at work? Do you take shortcuts? Do you do just enough so people don't come and get you in trouble? Are you crafty? Can you break that habit for Allah? Are you a fox? Hypocrisy and deceit under the guise of piety. Do you pretend to be something, but deep down you're something else? Can you change that character? And then a sheep, do you reflect blind following or passive behavior, especially in the face of injustice by wearing ihram? One pledges to be more proactive, right? He talks about how jihad is now left in the graveyards. There's nobody who wants to commit jihad. They're too scared. Islam is for sale. And as soon as somebody makes them uncomfortable, there it goes. And that's a wave that's happening within the United States. We've become like sheep. So going to Hajj, you get rid of this. He talked about 10. I'm just going to give a few. Tawaf. What's tawaf? Circling. What does that mean? It says, symbolize the constant movement of life where human beings change, but God remains constant. The cube represents God being constant, but you keep moving. It prints about, and then you could keep moving. You could go from haram to halal. You could become a good Muslim, bad Muslim. But Allah is always going to be there for you. He's never going to change. And He's always ready to forgive for all your sins. You know, when you go to Arafat, and if you're not even allowed to doubt that God has forgiven you for all your sins. You're not even allowed to doubt. All your sins are wiped out. But when you come back, did you change? Represents breaking down racism. Why does it break down racism? What person do you have to go around? When I was in Umrah, I kept going around this grave. Who's there? Which person? Not Ibrahim. Prophet Ibrahim's, because Hajj is a reenactment of Prophet Ibrahim and his wife Hajar and Ishmael. Yes or no? Who do you have to go around? His wife. Who is she? A black woman, a slave who was married to a prophet. You have to go around that. So that destroys your racism, destroys arrogance. The next one, stoning the devil. Right? What does that represent? Because I know there's therapy where people have so much trauma from childhood or so much things holding on. What's one therapy that works is people grab stones and what do? They throw it. And it works because you take something from your childhood or take some subconscious belief. Especially with people who've been molested, been raped, it's a real good way of just letting it go. And then they teach you the art of forgiveness. So what does it say here? Rejecting personal vices. The ritual involves throwing pebbles at pillars that symbolize the devil. It's a symbolic act of rejecting shaitan and vices. Seven pebbles, why? Represents seven sins. What are the seven sins, seven pebbles that you're going to throw away as a personal vice or negative trait? You're there and you say, Allah, I'm making a promise. Throw it. And when you do, right away, when you come back to this world, Allah shows it to you. See that sin you stopped? Watch what I'm going to show you. And it happens so fast. That's why it's so encouraged to go to Hajj. Because when you go and you come back and you made these promises to God, God instantly changes the picture in your life. Everything changes. It happens then, and it could also happen when you have children. When you have children, Allah promises things to change if that child is for Allah, not for your own ego. And Allah changes, and people will tell the story. We had one kid, we had some money, we had two kids, my God, and then three kids, our whole life's changed. All right. Dar Ishmael, the sacrifice, right, at the end. What is that? That represents what Ishmael had to do to who? His son, or reverse, Prophet Ibrahim had to do to Ishmael. So he says, sacrificing one personal Ishmael, encouraging, reflecting one personal sacrifice. What's your Ishmael? He says, what is yours? You're going to go to Hajj. What's your sacrifice? He was willing to sacrifice his son for Allah. What is one thing that you are willing to sacrifice? If you went to Hajj, and it's at the end, and now you have to do your Ishmael, your sacrifice, what do you think you would sacrifice in order to get closer to Allah? What's one thing you'd give up that you have an affinity for, and you would ask Allah, show me by me giving this up that it worked? Because as soon as you have that experience, you're like, oh, wow, it worked. Have that conversation next to you. If you were at Hajj, what would be your Ishmael? What would be your sacrifice? Go.
Abe's book, Greater Sins, he mentions one of the greatest sins is thinking wrong. So that's how.
Oh, yeah. Great point. I'll share it. Okay, let's do two shares. Who would like to share their Ishmael? What's your Ishmael? What's yours? I'm sorry? Arrogance. When somebody tells me something is wrong with me, I'm not going to be arrogant and tell them to buzz off. Something's wrong with you too. Who else would like to share? Your phone. That's the biggest idol. How do we know we have a problem? If I told you guys, give me your phone for a week and come back, how would you feel for the first few days? Oh, you'd be miserable, right? Anything that you have affinity, if you lose it, you'd be miserable. It's something that you have to spend less time with. And what better start than your phone? Just take your screen time. An average screen time here is 10 hours. Just cut it in half. Let that be your Ishmael. And watch how your mood goes way up. All right. I'm going to show a quick video. Because I want to show when you identify with consciousness, your consciousness, and you connect to the divine, that's all that you need. That's why we do healings. That's why we've helped people. How? By invoking the name of Allah, where they submit, surrender, believe in Allah and possibility, and they are no longer a victim of their past. And when they do that, their body responds. They upregulate their genes. It's the same thing when you go to Umrah. It's the same thing when you go to Ziyarat. We know people who have been blind who are able to see, people who have cancer healed. How does that happen? You have to submit, surrender, and believe in Allah and break affinities and no longer be held by the trauma of your past. But what group are you in? And for some of you, you have to experience it firsthand. It's like jinns. Some of us don't believe in jinns until we see it. So some people will recite du'as to see them for 40 days, and then when they see them, they get scared. It's like, why did you have to see it? Allah already tells you they exist. All right. By the way, don't pray to see jinns, please. I don't want to. Because then you're going to have somebody pray over you to get rid of it. You don't want to be possessed by a jinn.
Tonic thoughts produce tonic chemicals. Toxic thoughts produce toxic chemicals.
How deeply can we influence our bodies, the bodies of our loved ones, when it comes to healing, or the world beyond?
I encourage all of you to watch this documentary. It's called Heal. That's on Gaia Videos. Now, just the 2 minutes where Joe Dispenza is going to speak about how he healed himself through the divine. It's an amazing story.
In order for some of us to wake up, we need a wake-up call. And in 1986, I got the call. I was in a triathlon in Palm Springs, California, and I was in the biking portion of the race. And I was coming up to this intersection, so as I made the turn, a four-wheel drive Bronco going about 55 miles an hour hit me from behind and catapulted.
What would your thought be if you had told you're paralyzed, you're never going to walk again? What kind of thoughts will you have? Positive or negative?
Negative.
Because that's the way we've been primed. He decided to say, have one positive thought, and that's what he's going to talk about.
Made the body, heals the body. And I couldn't stop thinking about that because I knew that there's an intelligence that's giving us life that keeps our heart beating and digesting our food. So I decided that I was going to make contact with this intelligence, and I was going to give it a plan. A template, a design. And when I was happy with my creation, I was going to surrender this creation to a greater mind because it knows how to heal. Wait.
And he's become the best at it in the country from the Western side of teaching people that mind-body connection. But what did he do? He made a promise to Allah. He said, Allah, show me how to heal myself, and I'll show the world. And that's what he's did. And now he's impacted mainstream, where millions of people now have been impacted by his work. That's powerful. That is Allah. Because he says, the one that creates the body could heal me. Why do I need anything else? And so when people see a wave, so you could just look up anything, Joe Dispenza, testimonial, look up any issue, anything. And you'll see a regular person coming up on stage. Because to me, a person told me, I got healed. I was in Oakwood Hospital, Beaumont. I had 2 weeks to live. And because I'm interviewing his son to come to our school, and he's telling me his story. He says, I prayed to Abu Fadl Abbas. He said, I want to help Imam Hussein the same way Abu Fadl Abbas helped. Allah, allow me to live. I have a purpose. And if you allow me to live, I'm only going to do Imam Hussein's work. Guess what? Something happened. He submitted, surrendered, and believed. And he no longer was a victim. And he hit the sweet spot. Because for most of us, if I tell you to close your eyes, a negative thought comes. So for Joe, it took him 3 hours. It took him 6 weeks to figure out a way to meditate for 3 hours without having negative thought. To be completely submissive. Think about here. You guys are here. Why have one negative thought? Think about the negative thoughts you're having. Why do people keep coming up and getting down? It's kind of hot in here. It's a little bit long. I got to check my phone. What does this person want? Why does this person next to me keep talking? Over and over and over. Now you're trying to connect to Allah. Good luck. But what's cool about our faith, Sharia, is we get to try that 5 times a day minimum. 5 times a day you get to connect to the divine. And if it didn't work then and your mind wandered, well, you get another try. Every day for the rest of your life, Allah says, connect with me. Watch how I create a reality. He did it once. Were you able to heal his spine? So within the same documentary, we have Kelly Turner, researcher, author, doctor. What did she do? Because she noticed everybody's treating the symptoms, not the problems. She went and studied radical remissions, thousands of people. She interviewed them. She said, these are people that healed themselves, thyroid issues, cancer, all types of issues. And we have this, and we believe this in our faith, right? We don't need these people to tell us that how prayer works. You know, there's a method of reading. Just, you're going through problems? Start simple. Four kuls. The four kuls. Kul huwa Allahu ahad. Kul a'udhu birabbin nas. Ayatul kursi. And the last two ayahs of Surah Baqarah. And then just allow your body to feel all that and then go to sleep. And then ask Allah to show you a sign. We have this within our traditions. We don't need these people. Our problem is we don't believe in it until we see it. That's why you have to go around the trendsetters like a Joe Dispenza or the scholars that are into this work and say, ah, I'm going to follow that. Unfortunately, we've lost a little bit of that spirit. Okay. This is what she found in all 2,000. Out of the 70 things that she found, there was 9 overlapping reasons why people had remission. These were people who were sent home to die. Said, okay, how did you survive? They had these 9 overlapping. Radical changing your diet, taking control of your health, following your intuition, using herbs, releasing suppression emotion. That's what I do. When I counsel, as soon as I teach somebody how to release suppressed emotions, their whole life changes. I'm good at that. Because as soon as I sit with somebody, like, man, what have you been through? What kind of storm have you been through? What kind of hell? I said, well, how can you tell? I said, just look at by the way you're sitting. And I become good at it because I've been doing it since 2007. So it's like dribbling a basketball. The more you do it, the better you become. Increasing positive emotions, embracing social support, depending on your spiritual connection, have a strong reason for living. To have a remission, you just need one of these. Just one. And you get a remission if you surrender. What's interesting, there's only 2 that are outside. The herbs and the change. Our imam says, watch what you eat, you will heal yourself. It's the healings in the food. For each one of these, there's a hadith, a tradition that we have from the prophets and the imams. And there's a method to cure yourself. We don't need anything. I don't need Joe Dispenza. I don't need anybody. We have the prophet and the teachings. It suffices. Our problem is, unfortunately, we need some white guy to tell us how to do things. Because that's the way we've been conditioned. The rest are inner. Taking control of your health, following your intuition, releasing suppressed emotions, increasing. All you have to do is one of these things. And trust me, if you live in America, I and the rest of you have something to work on. Agreed? Yes or no? There's only a few people that I know that are not controlled through this world. And I've met thousands of people, and I know 2. One I'm close with, one is a scholar, that I know for sure doesn't have this. And they create from the field and literally whatever they pray for, and their wishes are Allah's wishes. What I wish for is my wish. It's what you want. How do you know if it's Allah? Their wishes are only Allah's wishes. And for me, that's what I've been studying for the past 7 years, are the scholars that are able to reach that reality. And they talk about it. And it's mind-blowing. That's another discussion. Okay. How do we get into lack, into sickness, is when we lack purpose. What's the proof? Imagine if you're drowning in the ocean. You're drowning. And you have severe back problems, and your wife just left you, and you just found out your kid did something bad. You're drowning. If somebody comes to you and says, you're drowning, are you going to be telling them about your kids or your ex-wife or anything? What's the only thing you're going to be focused on? Surviving, breathing. That's how your relationship should be with Allah. You're so zoned in. When bad things happening, say, oh, Allah will take care of this. I'm not going to allow my emotional state to fall victim into the lower centers. And I'm not going to be negative about it. That's how you know you've held this world, is if you can control your emotional state. Most people's emotional state are controlled and influenced and manipulated. You agree? Yes. So if you can control your emotional state, that's when the healing happens. And that's why prayer is so important. And if you can't do it, it's recommended. Go to ziyarat. Go to a retreat. Go somewhere where you could disconnect from your old self. And in Islam, we have that. That's why it's so important to disconnect, break the habit, to connect to Allah. You can't keep doing it with the same mind that created it. You have to be greater than yourself. All right. A lack of purpose can lead to losing sight of our goals and disconnecting from envisioning a new future in Islam. Having a guiding principle or mission is essential. Without this, how can we ensure that the choices we make align with the path we want to follow, is guided by our faith and personal aspirations? Meaning, if you have something greater than yourself that you want to do for Allah, you're not going to allow people to manipulate you. That's the key about your life, is what is your true purpose? So today, we're going to go to step one. And this will be the last slide, the tipping point. Where do I find it challenging to see the meaning or direction as a Muslim? How can I seek guidance in these areas? That's one. There's three that you're going to have to pick one. All I need you to do is pick one out of the three. And we're going to see if you could have an impact in your life out of one of the three. Second, am I practicing self-reflection in the light of Islam? Am I conscious of my thoughts, feelings, and actions in accordance with my faith? Or what Islamic teachings or practices could excite me to start my day with gratitude and being excited? And then you tie it into one of the emotions. You say, this is who I'm going to start being, and you tie the emotion to something that you want to do. Can you do that? Can everybody pick one? Can you have that conversation with the person next to you? But wait, this should be your Ismail. This should be your sacrifice. But what's the condition? Ask Allah to show you a sign. And I'm big on that. And I could give you 1,000 stories. What time we have? Perfect, because I'll get to end early. So can you guys, I'm not going to even share testimonials, because stories will really convince you. But I think a lot of you have heard them. And this is all I do, is I say, oh, you are, I don't need to convince you. Okay, go do this, come back in 3 weeks. There's two brothers here. They just came from out of town. They were 15, 16. Are they here? No. Okay, they just came. 15, 16, they said, okay, how do we change? I said, okay, what's your sacrifice? How do you treat your parents? How do you behave? Now they're 20, 21, and this year we're talking about how they're going to generate now 20, before it was $10 million, now $20 million. Now they're 20. And what's their mission? To build wells, to help the orphans. That's the only interest they have. And I could go on and on about stories, from wealth to relationships to everything you want in your life. You don't need anything, anybody but Allah. But you have to sacrifice something that when you become uncomfortable, guess what? You do it anyway and you don't cry about it. And if you have a problem with that, go read some David Goggins. He'll really be tough with you. Some of us need that tough love. Like, come on. What do you mean you don't feel like it? That's your body. Stop obeying it. How many of you last night said, I'm going to wake up in the morning and go to the gym? And 5 o'clock in the morning comes, the mind says, gym. What does the body say? Go back to sleep, you bum. And then we fall back to the program. Anything hard in your life, it's not your fault. It's a bad program from childhood. Every time. It's not your fault. But the good news is you get to reprogram it. I have, just like the Joe, I have a 2-minute video. So what I want you to do while I get the video set is tell the person next to you, what is a way you're going to create your Ismail? Go. Pick one with an emotion. This is how the people change their life. Cancer, disease, blindness. You could read the book. All right, we're going to watch the video. So nobody leave. We have 2 minutes left, and then we'll end. Now, this is a He's is in organic chemistry, his background.
Now showing that every organ in the human body has the ability to
This is not the right spot. Sorry.
Even the organs we were told could not. So spinal cord tissue, brain tissue, heart tissue, pancreatic tissue, prostate tissue, all of these. But what fascinated me more so, I'd say, was what happens when you test the drugs. So let's say in a typical trial, you might give 100
He's a chemist.
To show that it works. So you've also got to give 100 people a placebo for comparison purposes. And you might get, say, 75 people improving on the drug. It's not uncommon to get 40, 50, 60, 70, 70.
You guys get that? So drug, he's a pharmacist, organic chemistry. They give him a drug. They see 75 people impact. But then they give the same people a sugar pill. It has the same impact in some instances. So then he asked the question, how is a sugar pill creating the same effect as a drug? Because every drug that's given out, you first have to test it against the placebo. So what's a placebo? Is I tell you it's a Motrin, but it's a sugar pill. So then somebody like Joe Dispenza will come and say, well, instead of being tricked and thinking and then your body responding, can you become the placebo? Thus, he wrote a book called You Are the Placebo. So watch, listen to him talk about it.
Before 75, sometimes even also improving on the placebo because they think they're getting a drug. And I thought, whoa, it's amazing. What we see here is belief itself shifts biology. And I don't think that's taught enough in medical schools.
So how is it that you can give someone a sugar pill, a saline injection, or perform some false surgery or treatment, and a certain percentage of those people will accept, believe, and surrender to the thought that they're getting the actual substance or treatment, and they begin to program their autonomic nervous system to make their own pharmacy of chemicals that matches the exact same chemical they think they're taking? So the question is it the inert substance that's doing the healing, or is it the body's innate capacity to heal?
Well, everyone seems to be aware of the placebo effect, the result of positive thinking. The important question is this: what is the consequence of negative thinking? Guess what? It's equally powerful in influencing your life, but it works in the opposite direction. While a placebo, positive thinking, can cure you of anything, a nocebo, negative belief, can actually cause any illness and can cause death just because you believe that.
Do you believe that? Yes. So then why wouldn't you pay attention to the thoughts every day? Because those thoughts can make you so sick. They could cause disease. They could hurt you. People have been diagnosed with cancers. They would die. They do an autopsy, no cancer cells. So what killed them? It was the thought. So why not wake up every day and say, these are the thoughts that I'm going to have. And just like Joe said, be conscious of the negative ones and say, oh, that's not true. Why did I just say that about myself? Trust me, if I brought somebody on stage and I tell you, talk to me about your past and your future, I would catch you about 15 times where you talk so foolish about yourself. Then I say, would you ever talk to your friends that way? Would you ever call your friends stupid or it's too hard or they can't do it? They said, no. So that's Allah's creation, right? You wouldn't speak bad to us. They said, no. I said, but you're also Allah's creation. Why are you speaking bad? Why are you becoming your own nocebo? So you are the placebo. But you have to make a pact to Allah. Allah, I don't need anybody but you. But I'm going to follow the Sharia. I'm going to do my Ishmael. And I don't need anybody or anything but you. And when you overcome yourself and decide to make an impact, then those people in your family that are way behind, that don't want anything with Islam, in 10 years from now, they'll come to you and say, how'd you do it? And you become that trendsetter. And that's what I love. And like 100 stories just came up, but I think you get that point. How cool would it be 10 years from now, somebody in your family member comes and says, how did you do this? And then you change them, and then their mom comes to you and says, thank you for saving my kid's life. How would that feel? Compare that to anything else you could do in your life compared to that. Can you compare? So then why don't you create that revolution with your soul, create your Ishmael, and change for the better? And in this country, it's very hard to do. We're on usurped land. Spiritually, we've lost it to the ego. We care more about Taylor Swift being at a Kansas City game than what's happening in Palestine. It's true at times, certain times. But what's good is when trends start, look at Starbucks. Everybody would go. A new trend started. Look what happened. So you can do it. It's proof, but we got to start. We have a retreat. This is what we do for 3 days. I do it in Chicago. I do it in the cold. We're in a hotel. You don't leave. You're in a room, and it's 3 days of overcoming. And the biggest compliment I've gotten, it's people say, this is the closest thing to Hajj that I've gotten. This is the closest thing that I've, first time that I felt myself, my true self. Loved one, if you want to join the WhatsApp group, share three things that you've learned. We talked about Hajj. We talked about the trendsetters. We talked about the Sharia. We talked about so much. Share three things before you go about what you learned today. Go. What'd you learn? Talked about placebo, nocebo. Thank you. Sponsor? Yeah, if you'd like. Hajj Hassan made a great point. And we'll end with this. For everybody here, says in a book called Greater Sins, it's a great book, says one of the biggest sins that you could ever do is lose hope in Allah, thinking he's not going to forgive you for whatever mistake you've had. So be very gentle to yourself and don't judge yourself. Where do you get that from? Because your parents were critical to you, maybe. Because people judged you. Forgive yourself. Forgive those people. What's the key in healing? Any type of healing is forgiveness. But the key is first you to forgive yourself and your past faults. Then Allah will show you a new reality. And that's what's so... We have such a loving Lord. I can't wait. I pray. I have this feeling when I die. I can't wait to go back. I'm excited. This world is dirt. It's dunya. You get to sin here. Because of our arrogance, we get to sin. Can you imagine a world where you don't sin? And Allah says, peace, blessings, salam. Will you be amongst the believers? Allah gives a description of how it's going to be. But we could see it now because it exists right now. That's what's really cool. And that's why we want to follow these practices. There's no other way to follow. If anybody dares say that there is a better way, let me know. I'll follow you if you're the truth. Because I suspended my beliefs within Islam. I said, I don't want to believe in anything. I believe I'm everything because of birth. And then I went through 3 years when I made sure it was the truth. And it took me right back where I was. And that's the beauty within the deen. Thank you, guys. Inshallah. We all come together and continue to grow. What time is it?